Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to Nightline. My name is Bob Scheer. I'll be hosting for you tonight, and we have a tremendous program. We have some very special guests that are going to be sitting right here on this couch, and then we have a very special music guest. She's absolutely wonderful. You're going to be blessed. I was listening to her sing a little while ago, and she will touch your heart. And as a matter of fact, that's her testimony. She wants to sing in a way that touches people's hearts. And I'll guarantee you, if you turn the volume up so you can hear her, you'll get touched. I promise you tonight. Michelle's awesome. You'll get to hear her. But we have Landon and Allie Powell here tonight. Landon is the baseball coach for North Greenville University. Allie, you see her on Channel 4 WYFF here in Greenville. She is the lady who does a lot of the stand-up stuff there. And then we've got Alex Pettit from the Associate Reformed Presbyterian Mission Program. And we're going to talk about missions the second hour. So please make a phone call to somebody. I think when you hear our guests tonight, you'll wish you had called someone, especially someone who needs some hope. We're going to talk about hope right here in the family, and we're going to talk about hope as a part of the Great Commission around the world. So Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father of hope but through Him, and He's going to do that by the Holy Spirit tonight. And so if you need to be touched by God tonight, Jesus Christ is the person that we're going to be lifting up, and the Holy Spirit's the one who's going to bring you to the Father through Jesus. We're going to have a song right now. We're not going to waste any time. Michelle Cohen is here, and we're going to be hearing about this Jesus who walked on the water. Didn't I walk on water? God bless you. Thanks for being with us.
In the middle of a night, I'm praying for assurance everything's gonna be all right. And Lord, I see another battle is out in front of me. I'm afraid I won't be able, and I'll go down in defeat. And He said, do you remember where I brought you from? Just take a look behind you at how far you've come. Oh, and every time you ask me, didn't I deliver you? So why would you be thinking that I wouldn't see you through? And didn't I walk on the water, and I calmed the raging sea? I spoke to the wind, it hushed, and I gave you peace. Didn't I run to your rescue, and didn't I hear you when you called? I walked right beside you, just so you wouldn't fall. Didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I'd do it all again. Now she's talking to her father in a house that was once a home. She said, my bills are coming due, Lord. In 6 days, it's not that long. She hears a voice so soft and low. He says, I've moved like that before, and I'll do this little thing. Oh, and I'll give you so much more. Didn't I walk on the water, and I calmed the raging sea? Spoke to the wind, it hushed, and I gave you peace. And didn't I run to your rescue, and didn't I hear you when you called? I walked right beside you. just so you wouldn't fall. And didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I'd do it all again. And didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I'd do it all again.
And she searched till she found him, and she'd do it all again. And the reason that we can do that is because we know there's a hope out there, and his name is Jesus. And that's the scripture tonight, and we're going to read that scripture as soon as I put my glasses on. And from Job chapter 11, verse 18, Job was kind of despairing, going through a very difficult time in his life. He'd lost a lot of family members. He'd lost his about everything he had that he had relied on for so long. He'd lost it all. And one of his friends actually gave him some good advice. We kind of badmouth his friends so often, but one of his friends gave him some good advice here in Job chapter 11, verse 18, "And thou shalt be secure, because there is hope. Yea, thou shalt dig about thee, and thou shalt take thy rest in safety." The good news in the New Testament is that it's not about our digging that's going to give us hope. In the Old Testament, they were still not sure exactly how to have that hope, but they knew God was the answer. And this friend of Job was trying to help him to put his faith and trust in God. In the New Testament, we have these words from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." We have a living hope, and his name is Jesus. And we know that that hope is real because he was perfect in life. He died an atoning death for our sins, buried in a borrowed tomb, and raised again from the dead. And there's no evidence to the contrary. See, that's the beautiful thing. They could have presented a body. They could have presented some evidence, or one of the disciples would say, well, it really didn't happen. But nobody has been able to do that. You know why? Because Jesus is alive. He came out of that grave. Our hope is in him. And if you're struggling tonight because something's going on in your life, you hang with us for a while. Sit right there. And again, if you know somebody who needs some hope tonight, this would be a good place for them to tune in. So, because we have Landon and Allie Powell with us tonight, thank you for being with us, you guys. We are so pleased. Wanted to have you on here for some time. I'm just going to share just a quick little story about you guys. Landon is the baseball coach at North Greenville University. This was your first year, actually, first full year of coaching.
Yep.
And what was the record of the baseball team last year?
They were 8-38.
8-38 last year.
Yeah. Two and 18 in the conference.
2-18 in the conference. Yeah. And we had you guys scheduled in April, I think, to be at our faith day. I work with the Fellowship of Christian Athletes, and we had you all scheduled up to be down there for a faith day event one evening in April. And it was going to be good. You were going to share, and Allie was going to share, and it was going to be a lot of fun. And I got down there that night, and we were ready to go. It was kind of not a great night. We had a little rain, but I saw Allie sitting there, and I said, well, where's Landon? And they said, well, we just got a call from, where were you anyway?
Burlington, North Carolina.
Burlington, North Carolina. Yeah. And what was going on up in Burlington?
We were playing for the conference championship.
The conference championship? You were 2-what for the year before?
We had a rough year the year before, but last year we were blessed in a lot of ways, and we were able to play for the conference championship. And we won the conference championships. We were conference champions last year at North Greenville.
But you all had scheduled to be with us on that night.
Don't tell my players that.
I know it. Yeah. I know it. Where was the faith? Yeah, I mean, where was the faith?
Don't tell my players that. No, we had a great run at the end. Our team played awesome, and we came together as a unit, a family, and played some great baseball. And
you played for the championship.
We won the championship. Yeah.
And you actually won that thing. Yeah. And you actually won that thing.
It was the first conference championship in baseball in North Greenville's history, and went to the first regional in North Greenville history. So it was a banner year for the baseball program, and we're real excited about
it. Brother, let me tell you, it's good that you were able to be able to walk that out, even though you didn't have a lot of faith to start out with that you went and scheduled it.
Yeah.
But now don't get the big head, because now you got a little humility is the answer now.
And so baseball humbles you quickly.
Yeah, I know it does. So, I know it does. The ball bounces a little crazy sometimes. Well, we're glad that you're here tonight. And Allie, I want you to know I was so proud of you that night that you were ready to go, even if it was only you that was going to have to do the speaking.
Yeah.
It wasn't like you weren't ever in front of a camera or anything, but still, it's not quite the same thing, is it?
No, I usually rely on him to do all the speaking, so it was a little different for me, but I was ready, should I be needed.
Well, Mom and Dad were there, and they were encouraging you, and it was, and I had prayed, talk about faith, I had prayed that night that we'd have a short game, because we were going to have, at the end of the game, FCA, we were going to have our event. Mm-hmm. And I said, Lord, we want this to be a quick game, just a quick game, and boy, it was a quick game. We hope to get on the field by 7 o'clock. You know, the game started at 4. We're hoping at least no longer than 3 hours to get on the field at 7 o'clock. We get done. We were about the ninth inning by 6:15. I'm saying, man, this is going to be great. Lord's answering my prayer. We're going to have a quick game. And then it was the ninth inning. Then it was the 10th inning. Then it was the 11th inning, the 12th inning, the 13th inning, and the 14th inning. You know, when you pray, you need to pray specifically, not just for a quick game, but for a short game.
Yeah,
see, and that's important. Mm-hmm. But I just wanted to share that with you. I've gotten to know you a little bit. I hope to get to know you more tonight and then maybe in the future. But you have so many things to share with our viewers tonight. And I want to just start, Alanda, maybe with you. If you're not from this neck of the woods, you're really from up the road a piece, aren't you?
Yeah, I grew up in Raleigh, North Carolina, a suburb of Raleigh called Apex, North Carolina. I was born and raised there. And my family still lives in that area. And I went to the University of South Carolina to play baseball. And that's where I ran into Allison. And that kind of changed my path. And that has pulled me to Greenville. And I love the city of Greenville. This is a new home for me and a place that my wife and I want to spend a long time.
Well, I kind of hope you do too. And I know we have a lot of viewers out here, especially those North Greenville people who want to have you hang around for a while. But now, you had a baseball coach down there at, I don't want to get into all the details of your life and your future and all that kind of stuff, but you had a baseball coach down there at South Carolina, from North Carolina too, didn't you?
Yeah, Ray Tanner was my coach at South Carolina, and I had known him since I was a kid up in Raleigh. He was the head coach at NC State, North Carolina State University, and I was the bat boy and the bullpen catcher when I was a kid, and I'd kind of chased his coattails my whole life as a youngster, and that's how I wound up at South Carolina. It didn't really matter where I was, it didn't matter what school Coach Tanner was at. I was going to play for him wherever he was. And when it was time for me to go to college, he was at South Carolina, so I became a Gamecock.
Where is he now?
He's still there. He's the athletic director at South Carolina.
Athletic director at South Carolina, and you're here at North Greenville.
I am at North Greenville. Yeah, I love North Greenville.
Okay, I hear you, brother. That's good. We don't want to get into that tonight. But it is so good to have you at North Greenville. We love the school here at Channel 16. It means a lot to us to have that school up the road from us. We pray for North Greenville. We intercede. In fact, while we're saying that, this Saturday, for those of you who want to be praying for our during our prayer time, we pray the first Saturday of every month, and we're going to be praying from 10:30 till 2:30. We pray for the city of Greenville, the churches. We pray for the Furman. We pray for Bob Jones University. We pray for North Greenville University. We pray for Greenville Tech. We pray for everybody around here. And you're welcome to come, folks. We're not going to be on the air, so don't worry about that. We got a bottle of oil. You can come, and we'll pray for you if you need that. But we do pray for North Greenville. Thank you for being here. But you didn't just show up at North Greenville after you graduated from college. What happened? You were the man. You were the catcher for USC. Your first year, they went to the World Series and then won that thing, didn't you?
So my first year, we lost in the Super Regional to Stanford.
Okay.
And then the next 3 years, we went to the College World Series.
Now,
and,
did you win one of those?
We lost in 2002 to Texas in the National Championship game.
Okay, that's what it was.
And then in 2003, we lost to Stanford in the game before the National Championship. And then 2004, We lost to Cal State Fullerton in the game before the national championship. So we had a great run. I was fortunate to play with some great teammates. And in my 4 years at South Carolina, we were the winningest baseball program in college baseball. We won more games in the 4 years I was there than any other school won.
And you were one of the big shots on the team. And so they actually drafted you in your junior year. Or one of those years.
Both. I was drafted as a junior by the Cubs and didn't sign and decided to go back for my senior year.
So you went back to the senior year. You played your senior year, got your degree, and then the Oakland A's drafted you in the first round, right?
I was the first round draft pick in 2004 by Oakland, 24th overall pick in the draft.
Wow. Went out there, and where did you start?
So my first season in Oakland, they sent me to Vancouver, Canada, which was a short season A ball for the minor league affiliates.
It had to be short season up there. Canada.
Yeah, that's right. And it was a great first year of pro baseball. I really enjoyed it. Allison was there with me, and I had a lot of success and came back to Columbia. Allison and I got engaged. We're getting ready to get married, and I was working out in the off season in Columbia and getting ready for the next season, and I tore my ACL. So that changed my career path in a lot of ways. And
now make sure everybody understands, you're a catcher, right?
Yeah, I was a catcher. I'm obviously a big guy, and I was a big guy.
Kind of big, built guy, and a catcher's got to get down on their knees.
Yeah, so my
squat.
Knee was a very, very important part of my body for sure.
For baseball.
Much like a pitcher's arm. For me, catchers, you need your knees. You got to be flexible. You got to be able to get down in that crouch. And so I tore my ACL, and that changed Allie and I's life in a lot of ways. I rehabbed. I worked my butt off to get back healthy, and was able to do that the following year. So I missed the whole 2005 season. Allie and I got married, and we bought a house in Columbia, and had a lot of our life was starting, and together, and it was actually a great year in a lot of ways, just minus the game of baseball.
Yeah, which is a little thing.
Which was weird for us. We had always been, for me especially, I was always involved in the game, but Allie got to graduate school that year, and.
Now, you went to what school? What school are you going to?
I went to USC.
Oh, you went to USC, too. So you kind of got hooked up down there. That's where you met at USC. And he's playing baseball, but now you're in the professional side of thing. It's a little bit different, isn't it?
Just a tad, a tad. I had not planned on that, but it definitely came, and I didn't really have a choice. So.
No. You went with the flow, and that was Oakland, but you were doing in Canada, and then...
Yeah, so you have to go through the minor leagues. Right. They don't send you straight to the major leagues like football or basketball. So I had to kind of pay my dues and work my way up the ladder, and I did that, and with a lot of adversity. I tore my ACL that first time, tore it again another year later, so I had two ACL surgeries.
You know, I know your testimony, and when we're at the ballpark and we're giving your testimony, we got a limited time. We can go through all the details of all the different tears.
Yeah.
Can you tell me how many tears and stuff did you have?
I tore my ACL in my left knee twice, and I had a third knee surgery on my left knee that was a cartilage issue. So three major knee surgeries on my left knee, all of them coming at about the worst times they could come. The later two, right before I was getting ready to get called up to the major league. So as a kid that dreamed of playing in the big leagues, being a week or two away from getting your first call up and actually making it to the major leagues.
Now let me ask you, now 2010 was kind of a big year in terms of a special event that happened that year in your life in baseball. How many surgeries did you have before you got called up to that?
So I had four knee surgeries total, three on my left knee, and then also had a liver disease and had a liver biopsy, and I have a chronic liver disease that I have to live with. So all of that was part of my testimony as a fighting through the minor leagues.
Was that all before 2010?
All before my rookie year, which was in 2009. My rookie
2009.
Year was 2009. So. Okay. That all happened prior to making it to the big leagues. And a lot of that has to do with my journey, not only as a baseball player, but my faith and my relationship with Christ. When I started my career as a baseball player, I wasn't very tied in with my relationship with Christ. I feared God, and I was a believer in God, but I was a lukewarm Christian in a lot of ways. And as I went along my journey in the minor leagues and was dealt with adversity and reversity, I started to learn that I couldn't do this by myself, that this wasn't about me. This was about trying to glorify God with the abilities that he had given me. And Allison continued to work on my heart as well as my community and the scripture and just God, knocking on my door of my heart. And eventually, I kind of changed my life. In 2008, after my third knee surgery, I decided to start doing things differently. I wanted to glorify God with the game of baseball. I didn't want to do it for myself anymore. It wasn't about me making it to the major leagues. It was about me doing what God wanted me to do, doing it on His schedule, knowing that He has a plan for my life, and that I need to just trust in His will and kind of go out there and play for Him. And if I make it, I make it. If I don't, I don't. But be happy at the end of the day knowing that baseball is just a game and life is a lot more than that, and I got an eternity in heaven with God. And so He should be my number one priority, not baseball. And so a lot of things changed in Allie and I's life through all that adversity that I dealt with in the minor leagues.
Well, you know, and I think that's the thing that most of us need to keep in mind, that as we walk as Christians, it's not we who live, but Christ who lives in us. And we can trust Him during those times of adversity. Apostle Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, but it's not I who live, bad knees, bad kidneys, you know, bad hair day or whatever your problem is, it's not you who live, but Christ who lives in you. And Paul said, the life I now live by my faith and my trust in Him who loved me enough to give Himself for me. Now, you all listen tonight, I mean, if you're struggling with some things, the answer isn't trying harder. The answer isn't weeping and wailing. The answer is trusting Christ. He is your hope. He is your hope. And even when things don't look like they're coming when you think they should, don't despair. Don't give up in well-doing. In due season, you'll reap if you don't quit, even if you have to wait 4 days. He may be 4 days late, but He's coming. And that's the Michelle song tonight, 4 days late.
The news came to Jesus, please come fast. Lazarus is sick, and without your help, he will not last. Mary and Martha watched their brother die. They waited for Jesus. He did not come, and they wonder why. The death watch was over. He was buried 4 days. And somebody said, He'll soon be here. The Lord's on His way. Martha ran to Him. She cried, Lord, if you had been here, you could have healed him. He'd still be alive. But you're 4 days late, and all hope is gone. And Lord, we don't understand why you waited so long. His way is God's way. It's not yours or mine. And isn't it great when He's 4 days late? Oh, He's still on time. And Jesus said, Martha, show me the grave. But she said, you don't understand. He's been there 4 days. That didn't matter. Oh, the gravestone was rolled back. Then Jesus cried, Lazarus, come forth. Then somebody said, he's alive. He's to the Lord, I need you now, but He has not appeared. Oh, friend, don't be discouraged, 'cause He's still the same. Oh, yes, He is. He'll soon be here.
All right, he may be late, but he's always on time. You know what I mean? That's a matter of perspective. For us, he may be late, but when he gets ready to do what he wants to do, he'll do it in his time. The issue isn't, will he be on time? The issue is, will we have the faith that it takes to wait in hope? Knowing this isn't a hope in the sense of it may happen or it may not happen. The hope that we have is what God's Word says is true, and we put our faith in this. This is the hope, but it's not like, will it happen? Because of the resurrection, we know that it will happen because God is bigger than the death is. Nothing in this world is going to keep God from having His will accomplished. So we want to line up with that. No matter how late it might seem, God is always on time. Amen. And that's the word for tonight. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to His abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ our Lord. And we're talking to two people tonight who know about the resurrection and know about the hope of God that we have, that He's never late. He comes through when we need Him. Landon, you're telling us about we've gotten through a bunch of surgeries. You've got a liver issue, and we want to find out at the end kind of how we can help with some of the things you're interested in. But we also want to know about, even with all of that, that's when you made it. Isn't that amazing what God would have you get through all of that? And now, when it doesn't look like you, how could you possibly believe now I'm going to make it to the majors? Well, now all of a sudden, with all the bad knee stuff and the liver stuff and everything, now they call you up. How does that work?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. Allie and I went through a lot of trials and tribulations and a lot of adversity. And through all that adversity, you know, God called us to change our hearts and do things differently and have a different perception about our lives and about what we're here on this earth to do. And for most of my life, I was here to play baseball in a self-righteous way, to glorify myself in the game of baseball and to reach fame and fortune doing that. I think through the adversities and through all the things you just mentioned, knee injuries and liver disease and tough times for my wife and I, we both realized that that's not why He has us here. He has a bigger plan for us, even through the game of baseball, after the game of baseball. He was preparing us for that life, for what we felt like we would be called to do one day. And I think He was also preparing us for some later adversity that we would deal with in our lives. So it was a great feeling when we finally got called up.
So you got called up, and now you're going to Oakland, right?
Yep.
You're going to Oakland, the big city, the Oakland A's. I mean, they got a history. When I was a kid, that owner of that team, that just built that team right up.
Yep.
And he changed the game of baseball. Oakland is known for the city that changes sport, and it did baseball. Charlie Finley was the man.
Yeah, and that, some of the, his, you know, Connie Mack, Charlie yeah. Finley. You
big
know,
all, names.
Yeah, big names in baseball.
Well, and of course, FCA, Branch Rickey was the guy, one of the four guys that started the organization I work for, the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. So baseball is a big sport. It is the American pastime. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know people like golf, and people like football, but we're kind of baseball people here tonight, so we're just going to go ahead and get on baseball. But so you made it to the majors. Now you're playing in 2009. You got called up. But what happened in 2000? Can we go right to 2010? Tell me about
that. So after my rookie year, now I'm into my second season in the major leagues, and I'm more of a backup catcher. I wasn't the everyday starter on the major league roster. I was the backup. I played once or twice a week, and a lot of that had to do with my body, with my knees, and with the issues I had dealt with health-wise.
They're pacing you a little bit.
Yeah, so my body just couldn't take playing every single day. The game of baseball is a grind in a lot of ways. So I played twice a week, and on May 9th, 2010, I happened to be in the lineup, and I caught the 19th perfect game in Major League history.
Must have been amazing.
It's incredible. You know, I tell people it's like winning the lottery twice.
Yeah.
You know, that's that. You know, they've been playing baseball for 130-something years.
13.
There's been, you know, hundreds of thousands of Major League Baseball games, and I just happened to be in the lineup for the 19th perfect game of all time. And
19.
And as a backup catcher even, to be in the lineup that day. And the guy that threw it's a guy named Dallas Braden, who's now on ESPN and does a lot of other baseball work. And he's not someone that many people would thought would throw a perfect game. He's a left-hander that doesn't throw very hard and hadn't had a ton of major league success at that time. So it was a magical day. And I think, you know, the more I get to look back and have a reflection on that day, I think God did that a lot of ways for my life to give me some kind of, you know, magical moment in the game of baseball that I can use as I go on and have a platform through the game and help, you know, share his glory.
Well, I think that is the key, is the glory. I think whether we're sick or we're challenged, whatever it is, the key is to make sure God gets the glory. It's not about our getting healed. It's not about our being successful in our career. It's not about our building a great church or anything like that. Whether it's our healing, whether it's our prosperity in business, whether it's the success of our churches, the key is that the Lord wants to get the glory, and He deserves it. People say, well, you, Pastor Bob, you make God sound like He's some kind of an egomaniac. No. Hey, y'all, He's God. He's God. Think about it. He deserves the glory. And the amazing thing is, when we were dead in our sins and trespasses, He sent Jesus to die on the cross for us. I mean, He's God. He deserves the glory. But He loves us so much. He wants us to be His children. And He made it possible by sending His Son to die on the cross so our sins could be forgiven. And you can be forgiven tonight if you put your faith and trust in Him. Now, you guys put your faith and trust in Jesus. You went on, got to play a couple years in the majors. But then the knees and the sickness and all that stuff kind of set in. And you, what else is going on?
Well, you know, and then the big part of our testimony is what God has in store next in our life. You know, Allie and I had our first son in 2009. His name's Holden.
Holden.
Mm-hmm. And he's awesome. He was born in June of 2009. And Allie was put on this earth to be a mom. She's an incredible mom. And we both loved having a son. And we wanted to have more. And so that was a big part of our life, was to have more children. And
All right. Now, come on. Now, I know I'm going to go home tonight, and my wife, Ellen, is going to say, Mom, I love Allie. I mean, I love her family. My wife's the organist of the church where her mom and dad go to church. And I'm going to have to listen to this. And, brother, I'm going to hear, well, why didn't you let Allie do some talking here? And I know we've been talking, and you and me, we're having fun talking about sports and everything. Well, tell us a little bit, Allie, about your experience being married to a Major League Baseball player. Now you're moving toward the family. You got Holden. Mm-hmm. What's going on with all of that? How are you seeing all of this?
Well, I think it's funny because I listened to him talk, and he talked about all the adversity. And I think when people hear that I was married to a Major League Baseball player, they think I had a life of glitz and glamour and all of those things. And it's funny to tell people that, no, all those times that he was in the minor leagues and he was moved from city to city, generally he would have to call me and say, hey, I got moved up. I'm going from California to Texas tonight. Can you pack up the apartment and meet me out there? So I would literally beg the custodian at our, or, you know, somebody at our apartment to help me carry boxes down to the car. Or, you know, and it wasn't his fault. It was just the nature of that lifestyle. And so I like to laugh at it sometimes and say, yeah, it's not all glitz and glamour, but there were definitely some wonderful moments when we were going from city to city. And of course, starting a family is always fun, but a little more challenging when you're on the road and traveling. I mean, I think Holden was 6 weeks old when he made his first trip to Fenway Park in Boston. And I remember I had him, and I just kind of looked around at all the fans thinking, what was I thinking, taking a six-week-old baby to Fenway Park? But he adapts well now. He's pretty adjusted. So it was an interesting lifestyle for sure. It feels like forever ago now, but it was a lot of fun.
Well, that's great. Now, you are married to a Major League Baseball player. You're moving, doing a lot of moving around. Mm-hmm. Holden, when the girls were on the way, Holden was how old?
Holden was three. Is that correct?
Holden was three, and you now are discovering that you were expecting?
Well, we were expecting, and they thought by levels, blood levels, that I was expecting multiples. But I come to find out I was only expecting one child, which was wonderful. Mm-hmm. So I went, and I'm progressing along in my pregnancy, and the second ultrasound, they found the one child, and then they found what they called an empty sack, which was where a baby would have been, but they called it a vanishing twin. A lot of times it happens with twins. One will get all the nutrients, another one just won't develop. So they said, well, that explains the high levels. You still just have one healthy baby, but you know, you have that, it'll go away, it'll dissolve. So my third ultrasound, I think I'm about to find out whether they were boys or girls.
Or whether he or she was a boy or girl.
Yeah, I went to the doctor here in Greenville, and she kind of looked at me, and she looked back at her screen, and she looked at me, and she said, I said, yeah, I know, I had another one. And she said, no, you have two very healthy babies with two very healthy heartbeats.
Oh, my goodness.
So I had
surprise.
I had to call Landon and ask him if he was sitting down, because he was playing out on the West Coast, and tell him that we had twins. And his first words were, as long as it's not two girls, I'll be fine.
Well, if you think about it, two girls, two prom dresses, two high school boyfriends,
two weddings.
I mean, it all adds up. All the dollar signs are going to my head. I'm like, oh, no, two girls.
Yeah.
So I just said, as long as it's not two girls, I'm all for it. Twins is going to be awesome.
Well, you know what they say, when God figures there's enough manhood in the family, he starts giving girls.
There you go.
So I think I'd go with that one.
Sure enough, a couple weeks later, we found out two girls.
Two girls.
Yeah, God kind of laughed at me on that one.
I guess he did. So you got two girls coming. And how was the process of delivery and all that?
The pregnancy was great. It was easy, simple. The delivery was really fast. I went into labor. I think my water broke, and I think that I couldn't even get into the hospital room before the babies were ready. So it was a very fast delivery. But we had Ellie first. She was baby A is what they call her. And she was born. She was crying. She was doing all the normal baby things. And then Izzy came next. She was baby B. And they held her up, and she was not making a noise. And all I remember is they held her up in front of us, and she just kind of turned her head, and she looked at us like, hey, Mom, hey, Dad. Like, this is good. I know, this is good. I got this. And at the time, Lana and I kind of looked at each other, and we were like, is that
normal? Well, everything we had always heard and everything she had told me from all the books and everything that she read about pregnancy, is that if the baby's not crying when it's born, there's something wrong.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so we're immediately kind of worried or anxious, you know, hey, she's not crying. Is she okay? And the doctor's like, yeah, she's fine. She's perfectly fine. She's breathing on her own. She's healthy. You know, she looks great. And she's just sitting there looking
she's
at us.
Looking.
Almost like
eyes,
she's happy.
Open.
Yeah, I'm supposed to be here. And, you know, there's nothing to worry about. It's just a very profound baby from day one. I can't explain her demeanor, but she was a special child.
The wisdom in her eyes just was so deep. And it was, at first it was eerie because we didn't understand it. But as we got to know her, we realized
something unique was happening. And tell us quickly, what did happen? What was the process of the change in what was happening?
Well, you know, they were both in the NICU. Ellie was the weaker baby at birth. Izzy was the stronger child. And as they progressed, Ellie started to flourish and pass Izzy up. Izzy started to kind of regress and
get sicker
and started to need assistance breathing, assistance eating. And before we knew it, something was wrong. And we weren't sure what, but we knew Izzy was sick.
And how long was the process from discovering that she was not well to the actual going to be with the Lord? How long did that take?
Izzy lived 4.5 months. She was in Greenville for a month, and then we sent her to Cincinnati Children's Hospital in Cincinnati, Ohio, which specialized in, mm-hmm. in what we ended up diagnosing.
Was it Bethesda Hospital? Which hospital?
Cincinnati Children's Hospital.
Oh, Cincinnati Children's. Yeah. Oh, I know. Yeah.
And
I know.
She was mm-hmm. Eventually diagnosed with a disease called hemophagocytic lymphocytic histiocytosis, which they call HLH. And it basically is a disease where it's a blood disorder where your immune system tries to kill your blood cells every day.
Your bone marrow.
It's a bone, yeah. And yeah. So her body couldn't produce enough white, red blood cells or platelets fast enough. Her immune system was killing them all. So she was kind of she was dying from the inside out.
It's extremely rare. What was it, one in?
Well, there's only 12 babies born a year with it. And there's 4 million babies born a year in the United States. So she was one of the 12 in the United States born with it. It's a really, really rare disease. And so mm-hmm. She fought it for a while, and we could talk more about that. But
well, we have a lot of prayer requests coming in, and I think a lot of it is people are being touched by your testimony. And when we come back after Michelle sings, we're gonna pray for these, and then we're gonna hear the rest of the testimony and what the two of you are doing now in your life and the ministry that God's called you to. But in the meantime, Michelle and Jay, her husband, Michelle and Jay Cohen, are going to be singing one of our favorites, probably my favorite for sure, How Great Thou Art.
How great thou art.
Well, amen, and God is great. And we're hearing some testimonies tonight, and that God is moving, people going back to work, people are having their prayers answered, and we are grateful to Him because He is a great God, and He loves us, and He wants to minister to us life. And that's our hope. We have hope for life today. Because Jesus is alive today. Because He lives, we can live. And we're going to pray right now. I'm going to wait till the end of this segment to pray because I really want to make sure we have plenty of time to pray. I want to hear the rest of this testimony. But if Landon, you and Allie would lay hands on these prayer requests, we know that you have faith. We know that you walked through a lot of challenges in your life, even as young man and young woman, young parents. We're going to just pray and believe God for these special requests tonight that have been called in. Lord, we come to you now in the strong and powerful name of Jesus. Father, our hope is not in our abilities or our strength or our relationships or trying hard or being sincere. Father, our hope is in Jesus. We cast all of our care on Him because we know how much you care for us. You sent Jesus to us while we were still sinners, and He died on the cross for us to demonstrate how much you love us. Father, these people are calling in their requests tonight, and we're interceding for them. We are praying as touching these things. And your word says, Father, if we pray, if we come in agreement as Allie and Landon and I are coming in agreement as touching these prayer requests, if two or three agree as touching, we will have the prayers that we ask. Father, not because we're good, not because we're worthy, not because we love you, Father, but because you love us and you hear our prayers because we're your children. Bless each one of these needs, Father, each one. I know they've already been prayed for by the prayer counselors when folks called in, but Father, we lift them up to you. We add our faith one to another for each of these, and we believe you, Father, for healing, for deliverance, for meeting their special needs, for finances, for occupation, for career, for jobs. Father, we pray that you will, for reconciliation in families, Lord. Father, we pray for churches. We pray for the unity in the body of Christ. We pray for our colleges and universities here in this great city, Lord. Greater are you, Father. You are greater than anything. No weapon formed against us will prosper. You're greater than anything that comes against us. Thank you, Father, for the confidence that we have, not because of by might or by power, but by your Spirit, Lord. You're alive in us, and because you live, we live. We have hope in you, and your Holy Spirit is the one who gives us the confidence. Your Spirit bears witness with our spirits that we're the children of God. Thank you, Father. We don't even have to guess about it. We know it because of the peace we have in our hearts. Thank you, Lord. Jesus is alive, and He's alive in us. And because of that, Father, we know that we have the answers to these prayers, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 All right, Landon, going back to you now, brother. Don't let me down. My wife's one watching. Tell us a little bit about the process for all of the things that were having to happen now as a father, as a husband. What's going on?
Well, Izzy's life was a brief life, but it was a very special life. And God used our little girl in ways that we never realized or never expected. In her 4.5 months on earth, she never got to be outside and see the light of day. She was in a hospital room her entire life. But God used her in amazing ways. Some of our family had set up a Facebook page for her called Prayers for Izzy. And it started with a couple family members praying for her, then 100. Next thing we know, there's 1,000 people on the Facebook page following her life. And before Izzy passed, 4.5 months later, there were almost 60,000 people following her story. And so Allie and I would write posts daily, letting people know what's going on with Izzy, the things she was battling and going through. And what we saw is that people all over this world were praying for our daughter, praying for our family. And because of that, they were opening up their relationship with Christ. They were praying for the first time in 5 years. They were holding their kids tighter at night. They were going to church for the first time in 10 years. They were, God was using our little girl as a beacon for light, a beacon for His life, and using her, touching other people around the world. And it was amazing for us.
But I think also the biggest thing was we had to choose whether she kept the machine in that kept her breathing or take it out. And in that moment, we were so brokenhearted, but we chose to let her go be with the Lord. We had prayed that she would be healed, and we chose to let her. And I think what stood out to the both of us was we did not willingly give up our daughter. We fought tooth and nail for her, mm-hmm. but our Savior willingly gave up his son. And we got to see just a little bit of a glimpse in her life, what our Savior did for us. And I think it changed us forever because...
Yeah, I mean, after 4.5 months, Izzy had had 70 surgeries and, I'm sorry, 70 transfusions, 13 surgeries, five or six different biopsies, broken ribs, a Broviac, a central port put in her heart to inject fluid and drugs into her body, and 8 weeks of chemotherapy, a drug called Campath that completely wiped out her immune system. This little 5-6 pound baby was put through the complete ringer and was tough as nails and did not complain and did not cry.
Yeah.
But what we got to see is that when God decided, or when we finally allowed her to go be with God, God used all of that to show us something special. And like Allie said, he willingly gave his son to die for our sins, Jesus Christ, and we did not willingly give Izzy. And in that moment when Izzy passed, we felt God in the room. And he was showing us right then, like, how bad it hurt for us to lose our daughter. How mad did you think he felt losing his son to die for our sins? And so for us, that put in perspective what the gospel is all about and how much Jesus and God loves us. And it definitely changed our life, and it will always change our life. And so although it was the toughest thing any family could go through, and I wouldn't wish it on our worst enemy, Allie and I are so thankful that Izzy was our child and that God used us during that process, and hopefully he will continue to use us.
Yeah, and you have Holden, and you have mm-hmm. Ellie, and thank God for his mm-hmm. gifts. And but people ask, you know, where was God when I was going through all of these problems and this brokenness, and I've lost this, and I've lost that? And I think what I hear you say, Landon and Allie, is he's the same place he was when his son died on the cross for us. He was loving us. He was caring for us. And there's hope beyond this life if our hope is in Jesus. And if there's people out there that are wondering tonight that Jesus is the answer. Now, you're doing some things that go beyond now. What's happening? We've got just a couple more minutes, but I want to hear something about what y'all are doing afterward. What's the investment going on now?
Well, we do some things. We had a big event called Donors on the Diamond. We did that with Donate Life, and we are big in Donate Life South Carolina. We support that wholeheartedly. That took a break after we lost Izzy, but we're ramping it back up.
And what is Donate Life?
Donate Life is it's a national charity that benefits organ and tissue donation. And there's the local charter, the charter in Greenville called Donate Life South Carolina. And that's when you go to sign up to be the driver's license at the DMV, you have that heart mm-hmm. with the circle
okay.
around it on your, that
okay.
says you want to be an organ donor. And you can save lives by doing that. Our daughter, actually, Izzy, who passed, was an organ donor. And, mm-hmm. and we hope that her organs were passed on to another child to help save lives. And every 10 minutes in this country, another person's added to the national donor waiting list and waiting for a transplant.
That's amazing. That's amazing.
So that's a charity that we were very involved in. And it struck home with us after, obviously, my liver disease. I'll need a liver transplant one day, and that had a lot to do with us getting involved mm-hmm. Because we realized how many people are sick out there and need those type of things. And then our daughter, Izzy, also was an organ donor herself.
Yeah, and that's amazing that you guys have that kind of a heart to sow into other people's lives. Having experienced your loss, you're wanting to give to others. I think that speaks well for the gospel. I think that's what the gospel is. While we have special needs, we're going to invest in somebody else's life. As we sow, we'll also reap. And that's part of what the church preaches regularly. Sow and you'll reap. Give and you'll receive. That's the economy of God. And you all have picked up on that, and it's a great testimony. We're so grateful that you've come. Is there anything else you wanted to say to us tonight before you go?
Well, just thank you guys for having yeah. us and allowing us to share the testimony that God's given us. You know, mm-hmm. it's not an easy thing for Allie and I to speak on, but we feel called to let people know about mm-hmm. what we've been through, and we hope that there's people out there that will find the strength that God gave us. They can find that same strength and cling to Him.
And I'm sure they will. But let me just go ahead and speak it again to you, Allie, especially to you. I know Landon speaks a lot but in front of sports, kind of that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But you're on television, but it's not exactly the same thing. You've got an anointing on you, Allie, to share the gospel. Mm-hmm. There's no question about that. The Lord's going to use you exceedingly a marvelous way in the years ahead. To share not just the testimony of the brokenness in your heart and the way God moved, but you've got a teaching gift. You're going to share the gospel. Landon, you'll obviously share your gospel testimony, and the evangelism work that you're going both do is going to be tremendous, and we'll look forward to seeing it. I'd like to pray with you before we're about to go to our next segment. But Father, in Jesus' name, we bless this couple. We thank you for what you've done in their life. Lord, we know you didn't make Izzy sick. You're not the author of sickness. But when the enemy oversteps, Father, you get glory because people like Landon and Allie are willing to surrender their life to you so that you'll get the glory. Thank you that Izzy is taken care of. Bless Holden and Allie. Lord, glorify yourself in them. Bless this family. We thank you for them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you too. Thank you for being with us tonight. I know that a lot of our viewers have been touched deeply by your testimony, and we're glad. Now don't go away. We've got another great hour coming up. Please hang with us. We're going to look forward to having our brother missionary testimonies and other testimony. It's amazing how God moves in so many different ways. Come right back. We'll see you just on the other side, Nightline, in just a minute.